So, what are we about? Those of us who follow Jesus, what are we about? What ties us together? How do people know us? There was a guy who was elected president of my seminary who said he had to introduce himself by saying, "I'm a Christian, but not that kind of Christian." And he was talking about the intolerant kind, who thinks Jews and Muslims and homosexuals are all going to hell. We talked about that last week, about how there is nothing wrong with trying to live a righteous life unless it starts to separate us from everyone else. Indeed, it becomes the preferred method to separate us. But sin is separation, says Paul said. And we forget we are all in this together. At the same time, we see things happening that make us aghast at what people will do. Habakkuk talks about this sense of despair when we see a world where everything looks bleak. He's addressing God. Verse 3, "Why do you make me see wrongdoing and look at trouble? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law becomes slack, and justice never prevails. The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted." This guy needs to turn off the news for a little bit. It can strike us hard, and on it goes until we have a kind of world weariness. In German, the word is Weltschmerz, a sense of the nature of this world will never live up to our best expectations and to what we hope for. We get tired of the world. If enough is going bad around us, it's hard for us to see far enough to where something beautiful is happening. But God does not want us to give up. We cannot see the future. No one can. So God asks for patience, for faithfulness. Chapter 2, verse 2. "Then the Lord answered me and said, 'Write this vision, for there is still a vision for the appointed time. It speaks of the end and does not lie. It speaks of the end of the misery that we are in, the end of injustice and faithlessness. If it seems to tarry, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. Look at the proud. Their spirit is not right in them. Their experience is of disordered love. Their love of power and position means more to them than their love of justice and fairness. But the righteous live by their faith. If we wish to live by faith, we cannot be impatient. We have to know that righteousness will come." The Reverend Dr. King says this, "The moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice." So one thing we are about is faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Now we're singing that hymn to God. We don't give up on God because God does not give up on us. We put one foot in front of the other and just keep going. Faith is patient. What else marks us? When Jesus says, "By their fruit you will recognize them," how will people recognize us as his disciples? There was a great episode of On Being on the radio on Friday. Krista Tippett was interviewing David Brooks and E.J. Dionne about the lack of religious values in public discourse. Brooks is a Jewish conservative who writes for the New York Times, and Dionne is a Catholic progressive who writes for the Washington Post. They are discussion partners every Friday on Minnesota Public Radio. They show us what respectful disputation looks like. And while they are talking politics, they are reporters who do not shy away from speaking in terms of a greater good, discussing the moral imperatives of our system, where we fail ethically and spiritually, and how we might succeed. Brooks was talking about how there used to be public theologians like Reinhold Niebuhr from our own Reformed tradition, and Paul Tillich, a German Lutheran, and Rabbi Abraham Heschel, who was a good friend of Dr. King, and Dr. King above all others. Brooks said this, "We are now in a culture that's over-politicized and under-moralized. We need to become more communitarian in a society that has become too individual. We need to become more moralistic in a society that's too utilitarian. And we need to be more emotional in a society that is too cognitive." And religion speaks those three languages very well. The religious life is best understood, end quote. The religious life is best understood as a shared spiritual life, one lived in an intentional community, communitarian, moralistic, emotional. Communitarian in that we celebrate the community, the greater good, instead of the rugged individualist who makes no room in his life for other people, because selfishness is so much simpler. Moralistic, not in terms of judging others like the Pharisees, but in terms of saying, how can this awful thing be? How can we create justice? How can we work around justifications for these immoral actions? And emotional, instead of being too cognitive, too much in our heads, without our hearts. Cognitive, in this instance, is about thinking, rationalizing, and analyzing without allowing ourselves to be moved. We read about homeless children, and cognitively we say, yeah, that's a problem. But if we see some homeless children, if we work with them, if we learn a little of their story, then we are moved. That's what this means, to be moralistic and emotional about what is happening. These kids are in our community. They are small and despised. Do we kick them into the curb? Our society has. We need to be countercultural. So what does it look like to be able to engage the world to make it a better place in the face of all these situations where the law becomes slack and justice never prevails? The wicked surround the righteous, therefore judgment comes forth perverted. How do we get around that? E.J. Dionne thought that Dr. King set the tone, quote, "When you think about the civil rights Christianity that arose in the 50s and 60s, there was a spirit in that form of Christianity that was, on the one hand, militant and demanding of justice. But on the other hand, the preaching of Martin Luther King was very much about conversion and redemption." Conversion here means that, there's a fly on me. Sorry. Conversion here means that in a conversation, both sides are open to learning and open to being changed by what they learn. We might convert people to our point of view or be converted by something that they have for us that we have not thought about. Quote, "And King actually believed you could convert adversaries," unquote, said Dionne. Dr. King said this, "Love is the most powerful force in the universe. It's the only thing that can turn an enemy into a friend." And Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, "Who needs our love more than our enemies?" those who are trapped in a world of hate. Brooks continues, and we have very little of a sense that conversion is possible now in our political conversation. And conversion is a two-way street. People have to change themselves as they engage with each other, end quote. Remember, civil rights legislation was bipartisan. The Republicans of the Northeast joined with the Democrats outside of the South because the Democrats of the South were adamantly against it. For that to happen now, both sides have to listen. Both sides have to hear out the situation of the other. We have now become enemies to each other. And Jesus said this, love your enemy. Pray for those that harm you. It's in the Sermon on the Mount. How else can we look at our role? David Brooks has a great story for that. Quote, I have two friends named Kathy and David, and they had a kid who went to a public school. And that kid had a friend who had no real home. His dad had split. Mom had drug and health problems. So they said to the kid, come over, stay with us. Eat if you need, go to school. And then that kid had a friend in the same circumstance. And then that kid had a friend. If you go to their house, there's 10, 15, 25 kids there. 18 to 22, just getting some food. Last week, a young woman came and said she was 21, and this was the first time she'd been around a dinner table since she was 11. Now, I have to interject. These are the people that the launch ministry at the Moravian Church is helping. And there is a 6-month waiting list for them to get on a list for affordable housing. Homeless young people. Brooks continues. And I took my daughter once and she said, this is the warmest home I've ever been in. They call Kathy and David mom and dad. And there's just a warmth, an embrace. What we adults give them is the gift of being their audience. So there's a kid named Ed who would read from his flip phone some poetry he'd written. There's a woman named Kasari who would sing like a New Orleans jazz singer. And you just receive them, and they define themselves in front of you. In other words, the adult's gift to them is to listen. And what they gave to us was a complete intolerance for social distance. So when I meet most of you, I shake hands, and there's a little distance there because we don't really know each other. But the first time I walked into their house, I reached my hand out to one of the kids, and he said, we don't shake hands here. We hug. And so, big hugs, and you're just physically draped around each other. It's the opposite of separation. Brooks continues, I quoted this guy, Bill Milliken. He's been working on youth issues for 50 years. And he said, I'm often asked, what programs work to turn around lives? And he said, I've done this for 50 years. I've never seen a program turn around a life. I see relationships turn around lives. I see love turn around lives. And so setting up these contexts is what's being done at a local level. And the problem for journalists is this is why religion has become a way of seeing the world for me. A lot of things are more clear and more explicable if you begin with the premise that each of us has a God-given human soul, all of which are equal. And suddenly, you begin to see the soul in each person and how that soul was created and how it was formed. and what it longs for. And when you see that, you see on a much more personal level. Emerson said, souls are not saved in bundles. End quote. Our reading from Isaiah, which we did not read, includes these three verses. God is speaking. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rescue the oppressed. Defend the orphan. Plead for the widow. The oppressed in our context are people who have no place to live. The widow and orphan in our context is any kid without a parent, any parent without a spouse. Rescue them with relationship. Defend them with love. Plead for them at City Hall. Now we get to the story of Jesus and Zacchaeus. The story makes it sound like Jesus somehow knows who this is, but in a historical, theological interpretation, I can imagine that one of the disciples said to Jesus, "See that short little jerk up in the tree? He's Zacchaeus. He's the chief tax collector here in Jericho, and he's probably cheated a lot of people." Jesus, true to form and against the expectations of everyone, invites himself to a meal. The Pharisees, the disciples, all who saw him said he's going to eat with a sinner. And Zacchaeus was so taken aback, he repented before they even got to his house. Remember, the psalm today says, "I am small and despised." And it is the nature of those who are despised to assume the worst about people and to look for some leveling form of revenge. He may have pursued a career in tax collecting as a means of vengeance. Small people like to become big. Here are some people who are less than 5'5". Prince, Mick Jagger, Keith Richards, Rod Stewart, Paul Simon, and both Angus and Malcolm Young from AC/DC. They're all really short. They all became huge in their world. But here is Jesus calling out to him, and instead of denouncing him or mocking him or shaming him, he says, "I'm coming over for dinner and an overnight." Jesus read his actions, that he was in the tree because his shortness would keep him from even glimpsing Jesus, yet he would see Jesus. Plus, eating together is a sacred form of relationship, and Zacchaeus is being honored in a way that he probably never imagined he could be. What is Jesus doing here? He's reaching out. He's loving the enemy, in spite of what everyone thought he should do. And it isn't a program that he has designed to convert tax collectors to the righteous life. It was relationship. It was love. It was human interaction that has freed Zacchaeus from a short man's fate of isolation and being despised. It has transformational powers. Only love can turn an enemy into a friend. Let us pray. Dear God, our Creator, help us to have faith that we can make a difference. It is in our smallest interactions, where we trust in the power of the love of God, that we connect to those who we encounter every day. Dissolve our fear. Inspire our love. Put us in relationship. All this we ask in your name. Amen.